The views and opinions expressed in this program are not necessarily those of Union Broadcasting Incorporated, ESPN Kansas City, or its employees. The host is solely responsible for the on-air content. The following program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. Investing in ETFs involves risk, including potential loss of principal. Any past performance figures discussed are not necessarily indicative of future results. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Now it's time for the ETF Store Show. The investment pros at the ETF Store discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Jason will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of the ETF Store Show, Nate Geraci.
Welcome to the ETF Store Show. Nate Geraci and Jason Link in studio. As always, thank you for joining us. Boy, we have a lot to get to today. There's some new data out from Morningstar on the relationship between the cost of your mutual fund and its performance. And while we know cost plays a big role in how your investments perform, this data surprised even me. We know active managers already face an uphill battle trying to outperform the market, but the role of fees here is pretty remarkable. And I think this data shows just how important costs are when deciding which funds to invest in. So we're going to start the show today with that. And then in about 20 minutes, we'll be joined by Tadas Viskanta, founder and editor of Abnormal Returns. This is one of the more popular investment blogs out there. Tadas has over 25 years of experience in the financial markets. He's also co-authored more than a dozen investment papers. He's written a book. And we're going to focus on investor behavior, especially in markets like we're currently experiencing. We'll talk to Tadas about the emotions involved and how to know if you have the right investment plan in place. We'll also touch on ETFs and the innovation in ETFs. So, Jason, a lot of great topics today. We have investment costs, investor behavior, having the right investment plan in place, and ETFs. Not a bad list there.
It's a great list. We've checked all the boxes, haven't we? I'm really looking forward to our discussion with Tadas. Just a fantastic vision for the industry, and we do recommend for every investor to take a peek at Abnormal Returns. It's just an interesting blog. He really has a ringside seat and gets to look at and view some of the best thinking and best writing out there. And we, you know, interestingly enough, in previous shows, we've had a little fun with the prognosticators and the prophets and how hard it is to make predictions and how you really probably shouldn't lend too much credence to the people that scream the loudest. His blog is called Forecast Free. And so there's a couple of things we do agree on, but that'll be a great discussion.
Yeah, so he'll join us again in about 20 minutes. Now, later in the show, we'll have our usual weekly market update. We'll talk about the strong week from stocks last week. And we'll also spend a few more minutes explaining the importance of sticking with a good investment plan. And we're going to tell you what an old Mike Tyson quote has to do with this. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit ETFstore.com. You can find us on Twitter, or you can email us at advice@ETFstore.com. Now, Ben Johnson, who is director of global ETF research at Morningstar, we've actually had him on the show before, he just wrote a fantastic piece titled The Cost Matters Hypothesis. I tweeted this out last week, and we'll also post a link at ETFstore.com. But the gist of this piece was Ben wanted to evaluate the extent to which investment costs are related to the performance of active mutual funds. And what he did was he first measured the performance of actively managed mutual funds against a benchmark of appropriate ETFs and index funds. So he looked at a number of different categories, U.S. large cap stocks, U.S. mid cap stocks, international stocks, so on and so forth. And as you would expect, the active mutual funds as a whole underperformed the index funds. That really wasn't a big surprise. But what Ben did was he then separated the lowest cost mutual funds and the highest cost mutual funds. And Jason, as you looked at this, this data was pretty staggering. And we would encourage everyone to take a look at the chart that Ben put together. There was a very clear difference between the performance of the highest cost funds and the lowest cost funds. The lowest cost funds had a much better chance of delivering outperformance.
unbelievable data. And I would encourage all of our listeners to check out this article. It's a couple of pages. It's written in a way that every investor can understand, so don't be intimidated. The information is really interesting. I think it's important to take this down to the very basic level so everyone understands what costs mean. Whether it's a mutual fund, an exchange-traded fund, a closed-end fund, all of these products have a fee involved. That's an internal management fee. And it's not something you write a check for typically. These are deducted from the investments themselves. So think of it this way. If you have a typical fund, mutual fund, let's use that as an example, with a 1% expense ratio, that simply means that the first 1% comes out of your pocket. So the fund manager knows that I'm starting in a 1% hole, so to speak, every single year. So I have to out-earn not only the market if I'm going to, you know, try to be an actively managed fund that does that, but I've got to overcome the 1% fee. So that is involved with nearly every product, mutual fund, exchange-traded fund, and closed-end fund. So that impacts nearly every investor in the United States at some point in their investor career.
Yeah, and if we look at some of the data points that Ben provided in his article, over the past 10 years, ending 2014, only about 22% of U.S. large cap active managers outperformed. And that, again, you know, that wasn't a big surprise, and that speaks to the fees that you're talking about. And we've talked about similar data on the program before. But if you looked at just the highest cost funds, that number drops to about 10%. If you look at the lowest cost funds, that number improves to nearly 30%. Now, look, 30%, those still aren't great odds, but that's a pretty big difference. And this story played out across international stocks, emerging market stocks, bonds. Again, Ben had a number of different categories there. But across all, the lowest cost funds had an above average success rate compared to normal, while the highest cost funds had a below average success rate.
It's a tough comparison to make because all of the numbers are unsatisfactory to me. But we're talking about shades of terribleness, if that's a word we can use. Let's turn these percentages around. If you use the lowest cost funds, you have a 70% chance, a 30% chance of beating the markets. So 7 out of 10, you're not going to. And so that those are tough odds. Well, I would call that unsatisfying, to say the least. Well, you just take the average mutual fund, you're down to 20%. The most expensive actively managed funds, 10%, a 90% probability of what I would call failure. That is hard to swallow.
Well, I mentioned Ben Johnson previously joined us on the program. We talked about this exact topic, this relationship between investment costs and fund performance. Listen to what Ben had to say here.
There's one thing that you can take to the bank is that costs matter and costs are perhaps the only reliable predictor of future performance. And if you think about it, costs are your hurdle. If you're an active manager, you're asking the end user of your strategy for a certain fee on a year-in, year-out basis, and you have to leap over that hurdle, and ideally, from the perspective of your end client, by a pretty wide margin. So the higher your hurdle, the harder time you're going to have. It's really pretty straightforward.
So much of what Ben said there, he also wrote in this piece on investment costs. He said, fees are the clearest hurdle facing portfolio managers. The more they charge for their services, the harder they will have to work to earn back and ultimately justify their fee. He also goes on to say in the article, paying Ferrari prices will likely land you behind the wheel of a lemon. And then he mentioned Jack Bogle's famous quote where he said, in investing, you get what you don't pay for. And, you know, these last two quotes in particular are extremely important because there tends to be this perception that the more you pay, the better the performance. I think the thinking goes something like, look, as long as I'm getting good returns, what difference does it make what I'm paying for my fund? But Jason, what this new data shows is two things. One, paying for actively managed mutual funds, it just isn't a great proposition. We already knew that. But two, the more you pay, the less likely you are to get good returns.
It makes perfect sense. For me, this data, there are a couple of takeaways. If you're going to use actively managed funds, whether they be a low-cost variety or really, really expensive, you know, either 10% chance of success, 20%, or 30%, depending on your category. And none of those are appealing to me. So that's just you're accepting that reality if that's the route you choose to go. So isn't it interesting that you could set aside nearly all the analysis and just look to costs if that's the route you choose to go? And that's something that anyone can do. You don't have to be a financial genius or have a master's degree to say low costs give me a better chance of success. And that data, in most cases, is readily available. But a third takeaway is that there are different kinds of mutual funds. If the mutual fund is what you have access to, there are index mutual funds. And those are typically very, very, very low cost. So it's you know, we see the data and we see it parsed in different ways. To me, this really confirms what we've been talking about.
Well, and just to what you're saying, let me play one other clip from Ben, because I think this drives home really the entire point of his article.
Active managers, on average, tend to underperform their index counterparts, especially over longer periods of time. But you can pretty dramatically improve your odds of success by focusing on just the lowest cost active managers, that their success rates are dramatically higher relative to their very high cost peers, which you should probably just ignore altogether.
So Ben is saying you should probably just stay away from high cost funds altogether. And, you know, this topic of investment costs, I know we cover this quite a bit on the show, but the thing is, if you want to find easy ways to increase your investment returns, paying attention to investment costs might be one of the easiest. Investing is hard enough. You think about the current market environment we're in right now. You go back over the past 15 years and you think about the dot-com bubble and the financial crisis and everything in between. As an investor, you can't control any of these. Now, you can certainly control your investment strategy and your investment plan, but you can't control the markets. And my point is, one of the few things you can control in investing and be 100% sure that you have right are your investment costs.
Investing's hard, Nate. There are so many uncertainties involved and so many things that we can't control. And there are a lot of strategies to try to mitigate those uncertainties. But at the end of the day, we need to be focusing on the things we can control. And those are investment costs. It's really, it's the lowest hanging fruit that every single investor can scoop up. I think of it this way. You know, the last 15 years have been a difficult time for investors. There have been some highs and lows. But imagine if the worst thing you did was not spend an extra 1% a year on an actively managed fund that underperformed. If that's the worst thing you did, you just improve your situation dramatically.
Well, we need to take a break here. But in Ben's article, he also says, look, fees are just the tip of the iceberg. And he points out that there are other major costs of investing in the form of taxes, investment advice, and investor behavior. And he says all of these can be just as costly, if not more costly, than the fees on your mutual funds and ETFs. But what's interesting is Ben points out that if you invest in lower cost index funds and ETFs, those funds tend to be more tax efficient, so you can minimize the cost of taxes. If you're working with an advisor who invests you in low-cost index funds and ETFs, there's a pretty good chance that they're a fiduciary and someone who's not getting paid to put you in certain funds, so there's a better chance you're working with a decent advisor. And then, as it turns out, and I found this particularly interesting, investors who use low-cost index funds tend to exhibit better investor behavior. They don't make as many ill-timed investment decisions. And Ben included some great data showing this. And so, Jason, the end takeaway is all of these things are related. If you focus on building your portfolio with lower cost index funds, that can really help set the foundation for success in other areas of investing.
It truly is a mindset. When you look at the things you can control, the low hanging fruit, the place to start are your investment costs. And I think Ben's point that is terrific, and that for investors who focus on minimizing investment costs, there are a number of fantastic unintended consequences that happen along with that. Hey, are they more tax efficient? Probably. Do they tend not to underperform? Yes. And you can go, is my investor behavior, am I able to stick with my plan because my investments are doing more of what I think they should be doing? Probably. Those all come with the ride. And so what fantastic ancillary benefits that all start from managing your investment costs.
Yeah, in any event, boy, a great piece from Morningstar's Ben Johnson. And again, we'll post a link to that article at ETFstore.com. All right, let's take a break. And when we come back, we'll be joined by Tadas Viskanta, founder and editor of the very popular investment blog, Abnormal Returns. We'll get his words of wisdom on investing, including his thoughts on ETFs. We'll do that right after the break. This is the ETF Store Show.
Do you have any questions about your retirement strategy? Need help crafting a plan? Call an ETF Store investment advisor today at 877-365-ETFS. That's 877-365-3837. Or visit ETFstore.com.
Tired of running around town trying to find the best products for your business? Regal Distributing can help. With over 9,000 stock products in categories like food service packaging, professional facilities, office supplies, and sustainable janitorial solutions, you'll be sure to find what you need at Regal. Visit us on the web at GetRegal.com or call locally at 913-894-8787. And don't forget to check out Regal's state-of-the-art showroom and training center located off 435 and K-10 Highway. Go with the local partner you can trust. Go with Regal, distributing service and solutions since 1955.
Hi, this is Ryan Wiebe, owner of First Mortgage Solutions. If you've heard news lately about low interest rates and want to know if now is the time to buy a new home or even refinance the one you've got, give one of my experienced loan consultants a call at 816-778-7000. If you're too busy to call right now, just go to firstmortgagekc.com and fill out a full online application. Last year, we saved our average refinance customer over $457 a month on their monthly bills. First Mortgage Solutions, 816-778-7000.
The Wiebe Group, LLC, Kansas License MC00250009, Equal Housing Lender.
Hi, this is David Van Oy of the Van Oy Group at Reese and Nichols Realtors. Thanks for listening to my friends at the ETF Store. When making decisions about buying or selling a home, you need first someone who is knowledgeable and someone you can trust. With 9 years of experience and over $40 million in residential sales, I would love an opportunity to apply for that job. If you would like more information on a specific home or a property evaluation in Missouri, call 536-SOLD. In Kansas, call 259-HOME. Or go to our website, thevanoygroup.com.
Want a more beautiful, livable home? Talk to Schlegel Design Remodel. No one offers more ways to add value to your home while saving you money.
I'm Jake Schlegel. We have services for every need, like our popular one-week bath and express custom kitchen remodels, completed in a lot less time for a lot less money. We also offer professional handyman services for chores around your home.
Whatever your needs, call Schlegel Design Remodel, 816-361-9669, or go to remodelagain.com today.
There's never a bad time to see your dentist. So if you haven't been for a while, or if one of your teeth is actually starting to hurt, it's always easier to fix it before it gets worse. We aren't anti-dentites like the Seinfeld episode, so give Dr. Kevin or Matt Cummings a call at 816-246-1003 or check us out on our website, www.cummingsdentistry.com. Remember, floss the ones you want to keep and mention this ad and get a 10% discount on your first visit.
If you, a family member, or maybe someone you know have been the victim of someone else's negligence, whether due to a motor vehicle collision, an accident at work, a slip and fall, or a product defect, you may be entitled to compensation under the law. The law firm of Van Zanten & Onick is exclusively dedicated to representing victims of negligence in Kansas and Missouri. Please call 816-479-0404 today for a free consultation. Again, 816-479-0404. The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely upon advertisements.
Typical estate planning is transactional, focused solely on money, offering cookie-cutter documents, resulting in plans that do not address what is truly important to you and your loved ones. Bridge Builder's unique planning process focuses on the three dimensions of family wealth: financial, what you own; human, who you are; and intellectual, what you know. Bridge Builder, plans for life, architects at protecting and perpetuating family wealth for generations. Please contact Bridge Builder for a free consultation at 913-956-3984.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show. Nate Geraci and Jason Lank in studio. I'm now pleased to welcome to the show Tadas Viskanta, founder and editor of Abnormal Returns. This is one of the more popular investment blogs out there. You can find it at abnormalreturns.com. Tadas has over 25 years of experience in the financial markets. He's co-authored numerous investment papers. He's also written a book appropriately titled Abnormal Returns, Winning Strategies from the Front Lines of the Investment Blogosphere. And Tadas is now joining us via phone from just outside of Indianapolis. Boy, Tadas, great to have you back on the program.
Hey, Nate, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
Well, Tadas, let's start with your blog, Abnormal Returns. Basically, you curate content from all across the so-called investment blogosphere, and you've really developed quite a reputation as a go-to resource for both professional and everyday investors. Tell us about the blog. What's the goal here? How do you curate content? What can investors generally expect to find?
Well, generally, investors can expect to find really an overview of the financial markets on any day. And it's and to be clear, it's really not a news site. I mean, there are lots of sites that really look at the news and follow things on a kind of a daily basis. What I'm looking for is analysis, commentary, and research that really provide investors with some greater perspective on what's going on in the markets and kind of how to manage their portfolios.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, you have over 25 years of experience in the markets. You've written a book on investing. You have an MBA from the University of Chicago. I'm just curious, what type of content really captures your attention? What makes for a good blog or a good article or podcast? And how does that tie into your own beliefs as an investor?
Well, that's a great question. I think anytime, you know, you're looking through a lot of content and trying to sort through it, you're really looking for something that surprises you, something that you hadn't heard before. And obviously that's a pretty rare thing to find, but when you do find it, you kind of grab hold of it and want to tell everybody about it. So that's really something that I'm really looking for. And I think that's important because I think, you know, one of the challenges of kind of dealing with the financial media is that it is a bit of an echo chamber. And I think a lot of what you hear is kind of reiterated, regurgitated, however you want to describe it. It's kind of a little bit of a game of telephone. And I think when you really do find something novel, that's something you kind of want to, you know, kind of shout from the rooftops.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that echo chamber because, you know, look, you spend a great deal of time reading through all sorts of investment blogs and articles and listening to podcasts. And clearly you've developed a knack for filtering through the noise that's out there. But for the average investor, they're just inundated with news and headlines every single day. When you think about CNBC and the mainstream financial media and all the various online resources, how does the average investor even begin to cut through this noise? Because on one hand, I think it's extremely important for investors to stay educated on the markets. But on the other hand, we know the 24/7 news cycle can certainly stir emotions and perhaps lead to poor investment decisions. How can investors balance this?
No, obviously it's a great challenge. But I think one of the challenges for the average investor who really is, you know, somebody who has a 401k, they have an IRA, investing isn't really at the front of, you know, isn't at the front of their minds all the time. The challenge is that when the markets, particularly when they go down, they kind of hit the front pages or they hit the nightly news when things are really bad. And I think that's a real challenge because it kind of skews the way people view the markets. But I think, you know, the one way to offset that, I think, is really time horizon. The one thing that individual investors really have is time. And I think that investors really, you know, if you think about most people who are either saving for retirement or saving for college, they really do have a long time horizon. We're talking years or decades. We're not talking minutes, hours, and days. So I think from that perspective, I think the best thing for investors to do is really kind of focus on the long term. And the things that they should focus on are really are kind of the big trends. You know, one of my favorite bloggers, Josh Brown, talks about books are better than articles, which are better than blog posts, which are better than, you know, articles in the news. And I think focusing on the long term, focusing on your investment philosophy, investment strategy is far more powerful and a better use of your time than trying to focus on the minute-to-minute gyrations of the market.
Well, let's talk a little bit about investment strategy, because when you joined us on the program last year, one of the questions I asked you was, if you could distill all of your experience from the blog and all your experience with the markets into some takeaways for our listeners, what would those be? What should every investor know? And you answer that by talking a lot about investor behavior and the ability or inability to stick with an investment strategy. And as I look at the current market environment and I think about the constant 24/7 news barrage we just talked about, I think this is becoming more difficult than ever. So two questions here. One, what advice can you offer to investors to help them stick with a good plan? And then two, what if an investor's plan is a bad one? How can they know? Because clearly you don't want to stick with a bad investment plan.
Those are both great questions. Let's talk about the first question. You know, I think that one of the great challenges for investors is behavior. And I think we oftentimes underestimate the challenge of sticking to a plan. And I think that's, you know, in part because we really just aren't
we aren't built for investing. I mean, I think, you know, all the research that talks about, you know, in behavioral economics and behavioral finance really shows that we kind of our worst instincts kind of come out when it comes to dealing with our portfolios. And so I think there's a couple of ways to kind of deal with that. One of them, I think they're related. One is, I think, trying to keep things as simple as possible. And with that, I mean, we're talking about simple asset allocation strategies, minimizing the number of funds that you use, focusing on those things that you can control. And those things that you can control include expenses, commissions, and trying to lower one's increase one's after-tax returns and trying to minimize taxes in the meantime. And so really it's trying to focus on those things that you control. You can't control the markets. You can't control the geopolitical environment. Those things you have no control over. The only thing you control is your investment strategy and how you follow that. And so I think taking a little bit of time, putting down on paper what that philosophy and what that strategy is, provides you with a guidepost. And I think going to your second question is, when you have that down in writing, and if you want to revisit that every 6 months, every year, every couple of years, that's really your opportunity to see whether your strategy is a sound one and whether you're following it. And again, there's no that's really the only way you can do it. There's no program that you can go to that says, hey, is my investment strategy working? That's really kind of a question that you have to ask and answer for yourself. And it is a bit of a conundrum, because there's, like I said, the only way to figure that out is to kind of look at what you've laid out as a guidepost prior and kind of measure yourself against that. And again, that's difficult, because the markets are going to do what they're going to do, and that provides all sorts of cross currents when you look at performance. But that's really the only kind of way to proceed.
Tadas, Jason Lank here. On the subject of investor behavior, sometimes that comes across, at least the discussion, as those we're talking about other people. But in reality, we're investors. You're an investor. You know, as human beings, we sometimes suffer from the same maladies that the general public does. And I always enjoy asking our guests, is in your own investing, is there an area where you've really found challenging, and maybe some solutions you might suggest, and an area where you've really got it licked? Help our listeners understand the humanity here.
No, absolutely. Everybody has these biases. And if you don't think you have these biases, you have another bias, because
right.
Because we're all prone to these types of behaviors. And especially the more acute the market behavior, the more apt these behaviors are to come out. And so I keep harping on it, but the one thing that I've kind of come to over time is simply doing less. The older I get, the more experience I have, the more I understand that I really don't have edges in all sorts of different areas, and simply avoiding them is the way forward. I think, you know, all of the academic studies show that whether it be an institution that are hiring, firing managers, or individual investors that are buying and selling stocks or buying and selling funds or ETFs, it's almost on average and over time, it's always the case that the stock or fund that you sell ends up outperforming the one that you buy. And that's simply, you know, that's in part due to hindsight bias. We're looking to buy the funds that have done well, and we're selling the ones that have done poorly. And, you know, the markets tend to reverse those sorts of things. And so trying to avoid those sorts of decisions, just avoiding those decisions, I think, puts you in a better stead than trying to always find the hot fund, find the hot stock, find the hot market. And I think that's a real challenge. It's in part a challenge, especially in the ETF space, because we have this ongoing flow of new funds that are coming at us, and trying to pick apart the strategies is a difficult challenge. And, you know, that's one thing that investors need to be aware of. Just because there's a new fund doesn't mean you have to buy it.
Well, Tadas, that's fantastic. You just led to my next question, and it's more around the products, ETFs. Obviously, at the ETF store, we're proponents, and we talk about a lot of the positive attributes. But a criticism of exchange-traded funds might be that you're right, there's a tendency to overtrade. You know, we don't, just because there are levers doesn't mean we have to pull every single one of them. From an investor behavior standpoint, has the introduction growth of ETFs helped investors? Has it hurt them? Is it net positive, net negative? What's your take on that?
You know, I would say, you know, net, I think it's positive. I think You know, I think having choice, having options, having the ability to target, you know, your decisions with a specific fund that, that does what you want it to do, I think is important from that sort of perspective. But I think, again, like you said, that is a challenge. Like, it's, you know, there are funds coming out every day. And so I think from an investor perspective, you really do have to flip it. And it kind of goes to what we were talking about earlier. You really have to set yourself an investment strategy and a guidepost and let that be the guide for your fund selection as opposed to the other way. You know, what oftentimes happens is people see a new fund, they say, ooh, that's really cool, that's a great idea. It's a, you know, it's a currency hedge Japan fund. That, you know, I really want that. And they buy it, they put it in their portfolio, and they end up with a portfolio of all sorts of random stuff that really doesn't add up to a strategy. It's kind of a collection of funds as opposed to a thoughtful portfolio. And so I think from that perspective, investors really need to be conscious of that and flip it on its head. And they say, look, I want a portfolio that's 50% U.S. equities and 50% U.S. bonds. And I'm going to look for funds, that's just an example. I'm going to look for those best ETFs that track their index, have low expenses, and that really fill those two spots for me. And so, you know, obviously you can make for a more complex portfolio, but I think, you know, having the slot and then looking for the fund, I think is more important because, look, there's now thousands of ETFs. It used to be the case a long time ago you could count on your hands the number of ETFs and the number of asset classes that are covered. But now it's gone so far that it's a real challenge to try and figure out what all is out there. So I think being thoughtful and constructing a portfolio as opposed to having a collection of funds is an important way to balance that.
Again, we're visiting with Tadas Viskanta, founder and editor of Abnormal Returns. Tadas, sort of sticking with that theme, assuming an investor has the right investment strategy in place, they have those guideposts and they're building a portfolio, as they consider all of the different ETFs that are out there, what do you view as some of the most important factors to look out here? You mentioned investment cost and tracking the index closely. Are there other factors to consider as well?
Well, certainly, I think those are the two main ones. When we're talking about index funds, the cost and their ability to track those funds are paramount. And then I think a tertiary issue is their liquidity. So what it costs in terms of getting in and out of that fund. Obviously, if you're a long-term investor, that's not as big an issue because you're buying and looking to hold that over a longer-term horizon. So what the bid-ask spread is less relevant. So I think those are the things to look at. It becomes much more complicated when you're looking at funds that are either actively managed or follow some sort of smart beta strategy, which seems to be the term of the day. And so I think that's where it becomes a lot more complex. And it becomes, in a certain respect, the question is whether it's worth having to put in the education and the effort up front to try and understand what that fund is doing. And so I think that's, you know, if there is an advantage, if, you know, there's a lot of debate about the kind of the passive-active sort of debate and whether you should buy index funds or whether you should focus on actively managed funds. And I think one of the big arguments for following an index strategy is, look, once I have a fund that follows the total U.S. market, you know, there's really, that's pretty much it. If you, you know, there's really not a lot of additional effort that you need to put into it. And so I think if you're really trying to streamline your portfolio and streamline your thinking when it comes to putting together a portfolio, focusing on index funds, that is one key advantage there.
Tadas, I want to revisit something you mentioned just a moment ago around your investment plan. And I want to make sure I understand this correctly. What you're saying is that you should develop a plan, determine what problems you have, and then go find tools that solve your own problems. Not the other way around. We don't go look for solutions to problems we may or may not have and back our way into it. Is that what we're really talking about?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I think one of the challenges is that, look, the fund companies are in the business of gathering assets, and they do that in a number of different ways. One is advertising. Another is creating funds, the kind of a flavor of the month. And a lot of those funds are oftentimes able to gather assets. And so I think you have to look, you know, in a certain sense, you have to look out for number one first. You have to look out for yourself. and not let the the fund companies or the financial media drive you into a product that you may not necessarily need. And so I think it's, you know, I think that's one of the way to gird yourself against when, you know, when we do hit kind of rocky times and when the markets do get volatile. If you have confidence in your strategy and the funds that you selected, you're not going to feel tempted to switch into something else that happens to be out for performing at the moment. Anybody who owns a diversified portfolio is always going to be holding some things that are doing well and some things that are going to be doing poorly. And that's just kind of the nature of the beast. And so if you always feel like you need to be on the search for the hot new thing or the hot new fund, you're going to end up in that cycle of buying low and of selling low and buying high.
Tadas, we have about 2 minutes left here, and I wanted to ask you about professional investment advice. For investors who believe they do need professional investment advice, what do you think are some of the most important factors that they should consider as they go and interview an investment advisor?
Well, I think that is a great challenge, and I think there is a place for hiring a professional, because all the things that we've talked about during this call really come down to issues of behavior. And I think so I think you're really talking about a couple of different things. One, you're talking about at a base level, it's an ability to enunciate an investment philosophy that you feel comfortable with. But the second is really what you're looking for is an advisor who's really going to be a coach for you. You're not looking for somebody to say, hey, here's what you need to do, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and I'll call you in a year. You want somebody who's going to coach you through this process and to educate you. And I think even if you do feel like you need professional advice, you still need to educate yourself over time. And I think that's where it really becomes kind of a coaching relationship, where somebody can provide you not only with the services in terms of putting together a portfolio and managing it, but really trying to provide you with the education and with the kind of behavioral support that you need to follow that process over time. So I think it's really kind of, you're looking for that sort of relationship more than anything.
Well, Tadas, we'll have to leave it there. As always, a pleasure having you on the program. We certainly appreciate your time today.
Thank you. It was a pleasure as always.
That was Tadas Viskanta, founder and editor of Abnormal Returns. Again, you can find his blog at abnormalreturns.com. Tadas is also on Twitter. He's a great follow. His Twitter handle is @abnormalreturns. And you can purchase his book, again, appropriately titled Abnormal Returns, through Amazon. All right, let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll have our weekly market update. We'll look at last week's strong performance from stocks, and we'll tell you what Mike Tyson has to do with sticking with a good investment plan. We'll do that right after the break. You're listening to the ETF Store Show.
Do you have any questions about your retirement strategy? Need help crafting a plan? Call an ETF Store investment advisor today at 877-365-ETFS. That's 877-365-3837. Or visit ETFstore.com.
Business disputes are rarely just about money. Oftentimes, they involve a breach of trust or a fundamental disagreement about the terms or operation of the business. The law firm of Graves Garrett offers comprehensive and creative solutions to these types of complex legal problems. Graves Garrett represents businesses and individuals nationwide in commercial litigation, white-collar criminal defense litigation, and compliance and internal investigations. If you're involved in a critical legal dispute, let Graves Garrett be your voice. Visit GravesGarrett.com or call 816-256-3181.
The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely on advertisements.
Are life stresses beginning to take their toll? Take time to maintain your health by seeing one of our exceptional therapists at My Massage Bliss. At My Massage Bliss, we provide a level of service well above the industry standard by providing the best therapist, staff, and value for your time and money. Don't take our word for it. Our ratings and reviews speak for themselves. Come visit us in Overland Park on the corner of 143rd and Metcalf, online at mymassagebliss.net, or give us a call at 913-956-5100. We look forward to serving you.
It's a fact that most any day can be a special day for someone. A birthday, an engagement, an anniversary, a promotion, or an I love you day. It's also a fact that Lichtenberg's Fine Jewelry offers hundreds of ways to say love or thanks or congrats or I'm so happy you're in my life. So when you want to make your special day extra special, think Lichtenberg's Fine Jewelry, 131st and State Line, 816-941-2221.
The U.S. economy is often referred to as a competitive marketplace, yet many Americans don't understand the parameters of this competition. Why is it that so many people don't understand a subject that is so important to their daily lives? The simple answer is nobody ever taught them. The Missouri Council on Economic Education exists in order to right this wrong by promoting economic and financial education in Missouri. To learn more about our efforts and to get involved, please visit missouri.councilforeconed.org.
Do stains in your carpet keep coming back and now you're stressing over the high cost to replace it? Then you need to call Zero Res. Their carpet cleaning process does not use soaps or toxic chemicals, which all leave behind residues that attract more dirt immediately. This zero residue technology will not only have your carpets looking great, it also extends the life of your carpet. Check them out online at ZeroResKC.com or call 816-425-3655 and schedule your cleaning today.
For those of you who haven't heard, the oldest building in Kansas City has the newest rooftop deck. Kelly's Westport Inn's rooftop deck has a full-service bar, TVs, bathrooms, lots of fans, and an awesome view of Westport. Kelly's has a weekday happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 to 7. They also have live music every Friday and Saturday night. Come enjoy tunes from bands like Lost Wax, Flanagan's Right Hook, and Michael Beer's Band. Every city has a place where the elite gather for witty conversation over trendy cocktails. In Kansas City, that place is definitely not Kelly's. For more information, go to kellyswestportinn.com.
Do you want more exposure locally and nationally for you or your company? If you want to build your brand and reach more potential customers, then you need J-Girl Media. J-Girl Media is a full-scale consulting firm that can help you with all your media relations, PR, and public affairs efforts. J-Girl Media can also help your business with any marketing, mobile app development, digital media, SEO, or content marketing needs. Grow your brand in an affordable way. Check out jgrowmedia.com today.
You know what's really great? A trip to Italy. The food, the wine, the coffee, the pasta, the pizza. It's fantastic. You can't go to Italy right now? Not a problem. Tell you what you do. Go to Bella Napoli. That means beautiful Naples in Italian. Brookside. Bella Napoli in Brookside. They got all that and sidewalk cafes too. You will love Bella Napoli. Tell Jake Imperielli I sent you. He'll know what I'm talking about.
This segment is brought to you by the Bushnell Factory Outlets, offering big savings on a variety of brands such as Primos, Tasco, Hoppies, Bole, and more. Stop by either of our stores located in Lenexa, Kansas, and Lee's Summit, Missouri, and let our expert sales associates help you with your purchases. The Bushnell Factory Outlet stores serve as your destination to purchase the most extensive assortment of Bushnell brand of products anywhere in the United States.
Has it been a while since you or your financial advisor reviewed the investments in your portfolio? With today's ever-changing global economy, it's become more critical than ever to make sure your portfolio is on track. Whether you're managing your own investments or using an advisor, it never hurts to get a second opinion. At the ETF Store, we provide free consultations on your portfolio. We'll highlight the strengths and weaknesses and tell you exactly what you're paying for your investments. This is absolutely free. There's no obligation. Just give us a call at 816-363-3837 or click on the free consultation button at etfstore.com.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show. Nate and Jason in studio. Now it's time for our weekly market update.
And now it's time for this week's market update. Tune in every week as the ETF Store brings you the information you need to know on the financial markets.
A strong week for stocks last week. Both the S&P 500 and Dow Jones Industrial Average posted gains of nearly 3%, and the NASDAQ was up 3.7% for the week. For the year, both the S&P 500 and Dow Jones are still down nearly 6%, and the NASDAQ is down over 9%. I should also note that gold is up about 16% year-to-date, and intermediate-term treasury bonds are up about 5%.
You know, Jason, it's certainly been a turbulent start to the year. At one point, the S&P 500 was down about 15% from last year's high. We've now recovered over 5% of that. But it's this type of market environment that really drives investors crazy. It's very difficult to keep your emotions in check. And I thought Tadas made some excellent points earlier on how best to approach investing in this type of environment. The bottom line is, if you have a good investment plan in place and you can stick with that plan, you should sleep pretty well at night. But if you're tossing and turning and you can't sleep when the market is bouncing around like we've seen so far this year, I think that should tell you that perhaps you don't have the right investment plan in place. It sounds cliche, but your sleep at night factor is probably one of the best gauges out there.
It certainly is. This year to date has really been a study in investor behavior. We know the stocks have been awfully weak year to date. I tend to look at gold and treasuries in a different way. Gold has really had a nice bounce this year, and treasuries have also. Those are traditionally what we call safe haven assets. Those are things that people kind of rush to when the skies turn cloudy. And isn't it appropriate that on a show where we're really focusing on investor behavior, that those type of things are happening? And it strikes me more as a panic move when we see violent swings in those kind of assets, either up or down. That doesn't strike me as people following a well-disciplined plan. That really strikes me as people that perhaps don't have a plan or aren't sticking with the plan that they have. Of course, everybody's different. But that sleep at night factor, it looks to me like a few people didn't have as much as they wanted.
Well, what comes to mind for me in market environments like we've seen so far this year is the old Mike Tyson quote where he said, "Everyone has a plan until they get punched in the mouth." And I think there are several ways you can interpret this, but when it comes to investing, I like to think of it like this. If you have a good plan in place and you get punched in the mouth, so the market drops 10 or 15 or 20%, don't forget your plan. Mike Tyson won all those fights because he punched someone in the mouth, and then all of a sudden, they forgot their plan. They became rattled, and they started making poor decisions. They went away from their game plan. And how did that usually end? Well, with a knockout. Once they forgot their plan or they went away from their plan, boy, it was lights out. Well, same thing with your investment portfolio. Bad things are going to happen with the markets. That's a guarantee. You can't avoid that. But if you have the right plan in place, you're going to be prepared and have confidence when you do get punched in the mouth. You know, we had Ben Carlson on the show last year. He wrote the investment book, A Wealth of Common Sense. And I thought he explained this whole concept perfectly. Take a listen to this.
Everyone is investing in an uncertain future, but having sort of some rules in place and automating good decisions up front and having that plan in place so you're not trying to make those decisions when things are going really great or things are going bad. And so you follow your rules and you set them up ahead of time for if the market does this, I will do this. So I think just having those good decisions made up front instead of trying to do them on the fly is really important for investors.
And you know, Jason, Ben also likes to say the best investment plans and the best investment strategies are the ones you can actually follow. If you can't stick to your plan, it's not a good plan for you.
That's one of the most powerful quotes. I think we don't give it enough credence. You've got to have conviction with your plan. And I think he makes a great point that every investor must assume, it really, it's almost a certainty that there will be rough times. The probability of you being punched in your investment face is very, very high over the next year, 5 years, or 10 years. It's going to happen. And so the tragedy with not having the conviction or having a well-thought-out plan that you can stick with is that in times of turmoil, you tend to make a bad decision. So not only are you losing conviction on your plan, you're making a change when it's probably the worst time to do it. So you're getting that double whammy. And it's interesting, people don't tend to make rash decisions when skies are sunny and their investment portfolio looks good. It's when things don't look good that you lose conviction, and that's probably the last time you should ever make it. It is having that conviction and we talk about sticking with your plan. Any plan is probably better than no plan, but sticking with the plan is just step two. You've just got to do it.
Well, you know, you and I talked a few weeks ago about one of the strategies we offer at the ETF store, and I thought this was a perfect example as we were talking about investment plans and being able to stick to them. It's called dynamic risk management. It's a momentum-based risk management strategy. And the idea here is to capture the meat of upward-moving markets and avoid the bulk of downward-trending markets. And this has worked pretty darn well since the beginning of the year because the strategy was already positioned, you know, pretty conservatively. But to me, again, this is a great example of having a plan. This is a rules-based strategy. The way we manage this is clearly laid out up front. We're not making decisions on the fly, whether the market is up 20% or down 20%. It's easy to understand, and it's easy to follow. Now, this isn't a strategy for everyone, and it's not going to work in every type of market environment. But for a certain segment of our clients, we think this is the perfect strategy. And I guess that's my point. You need an investment strategy that fits your particular situation. You need that sleep at night factor, and you have to have a plan that you can stick to.
That's part of what dynamic risk management does. It gives a well-thought-out, well-constructed plan to investors, and it allows them to remain unemotional, or at least to some extent, with their own capital. Because that's one of the biggest hurdles we face is, this is my money. I want my arms wrapped around it. And sometimes doing something on the fly seems like the right thing to do, but it would probably be much more effective to have a disciplined, unemotional plan. So you want to start with a strategy that works. And with dynamic risk management, we just need to be more right than we are wrong. And no plan works in every single market environment. I think that's something that every investor should know, that regardless of how you plan, every investor will occasionally have periods of time of underperformance. And we need to be mentally, physically, and emotionally prepared for those times so that we do not lose conviction. So having a rules-based plan to maximize good markets and minimize poor markets can really be an effective tool.
Well, and I just keep coming back to the Mike Tyson quote. Again, everyone has a plan until they get punched in the mouth. You will get punched in the mouth as an investor. And don't forget your plan when that happens. I think about the old Mike Tyson fights that I watched, and you saw that right off the bat. You know, somebody came into the ring pretty confident. They thought they had a plan. They got punched in the mouth, and then they completely forgot their plan. So you want to make sure that you stick with your plan no matter what happens. Jason, we have a few minutes left here on the show. I want to go back to some of the comments that Tadas made earlier. I thought Tadas was tremendous earlier on the show. You know, he said humans are not built for investing, that the worst instincts come out. And I thought that was really interesting. You know, we talk a lot about investor behavior, and I think when people think of investing, you know, you focus on returns and all the different investment products, and even some of the stuff that we talk about, investment costs and taxes. But investor behavior is so important, and I don't know that it gets talked about enough.
It doesn't. I don't think it does. The actions we take, or actions by omission that we don't take, have such an enormous impact on what we do. He had so many great points I was scribbling down. Here's a couple of my takeaways. As you develop a plan and a portfolio, you start with your goals, and then you go find tools, investments, or solutions to fix the problems you have or solve your goals. You don't go the other way around. The hottest new fund of the week may sound great, but if it doesn't solve your problem, owning it probably creates a problem rather than solving it. I thought that was great. You know, the other quote, looking after number one, I think we all understand Wall Street is not a nonprofit organization, so you really have to look out after your own investments. And he made another just insightful point that if you have a balanced, well-thought-out portfolio, individually there will be some components that are zigging while others zag. That's not a bad thing. That's by design, because next week, next month, next year, it'll reverse. That's the point of having a balanced portfolio. But and lastly, you know, we're in the business of helping our clients manage their money. It was interesting that his suggestion is that we perform more coaching duties, that we help our clients not only with the mundane part of managing money and the research and all the dirty work, but helping our clients make better decisions, act differently, and make decisions that enhance their investments and other areas of their life. I thought that was really neat.
Well, also being an educator, he mentioned in terms of professional advice that, yes, you need a behavior coach, but you need an advisor who's going to educate you and make sure you understand the investment strategy and the investments that are being used. And that goes along with something else that I thought I would add that he said was just keeping things simple. You know, keep investments simple. Don't make things more complex.
Isn't that one of the general rules it's really where sometimes as advisors or our industry or product providers, you know, complex is better. More expensive means better. And I think that's a great point that if we solve things on a simple way that we can understand, that's very transparent, that goes a long, long way.
Well, we'll have to leave it there, as that is all the time we have for today's show. I do want to thank Tadas Viskanta from Abnormal Returns for joining us today. Hope you enjoyed that conversation with Tadas. And again, I would encourage you to visit his website at abnormalreturns.com. As always, podcasts of the ETF Store Show are available at etfstore.com and also Apple iTunes. Check us out on social media. We're on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn. You can stay up to date on all the latest from both the ETF Store and the ETF Store Show. We have another great guest for you next week. Ben Fulton, CEO of Elkhorn Investments, will join us. Elkhorn offers several ETFs, which we'll spotlight, but Ben has a very unique backstory. He's actually considered one of the godfathers of the ETF industry. So we're going to talk to Ben about the early days of ETFs. This should be a fascinating conversation. Again, that's next Tuesday at 3 p.m. Until then, have a great week, everyone.